came through and it was like I had just conquered the world. I was so full of emotion and pride, and I came through, and there was like, came through the finish line, and there was like three flashing lights, and there was nobody there. Like there was nobody there. It was like midnight. There was nobody there. There was one person with a little marker marking your name off of, and I just felt like I had just conquered the world, and there was nobody to celebrate with me. So I just sat there and I cried for a few minutes.
Kia ora tato. That was Jaime Stevenson. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
This is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners. I've been spending so much time digitally anyway at the Filson Library. And I found a library that I prefer to be in, which is the Wild Things Library.
Yeah. Again. Have you been like down there to Mel's place, Mel and Sally's place, and like sitting in the Wild Things Library?
In the hand-tooled leather chairs smoking cigars. No, I haven't, but I've been making, if you sign up to Wild Things, the VIP membership, you enter the code DCR2021. Mm. It's really cool. You get 15 months, price of 12. We know that. We get a little bit of ooh la la.
Yep.
They're happy. Mm-hmm. You're happy.
Because you get the extra 3 months.
You get the three free. Months. You can do the trail challenges. You can sign up for that. The mm-hmm. Autumn Auckland one.
Get discounts at the store.
Absolutely. Really good discounts at the store. But you also get these sick emails with library articles.
Yeah.
It's not library articles. I mean, you can borrow them. But it's stuff that you can read. So they go through and they collate. And there's lots of things in there from the sort of the useful for nine new tips for new runners or nine tips for new runners to the sublime, which is the Riverhead Backyard Relapse link to us.
DCR special.
DCR special.
Yeah.
You know, post-run stretching, going far, going faster, Dean Karnasis
it's
is
like
in
the
there.
Smithsonian it is of trail running.
Absolutely.
Basically, they collect everything that's great and good about trail. Because you can get overwhelmed, you know.
Yes.
You
just
get,
absolutely,
so
you can.
But here you go. You just go to one place in Wild Things, in the VIP lounge, hang out, take up a chair, and you can read through some of the best stuff that's being written and said about trail running all around the world too.
Absolutely. Just
so cool.
Don't reference the Wild Things Library for your pathophysiology exam. They don't like it.
Don't do that. Don't do that. Use the code DCR2021. So you just go along to wildthings.club.nz, sign up as a VIP member if you haven't, using that cool code, and away you go.
Ooh la la.
Read away.
You know that boat that jammed into the Suez Canal?
Yes.
Ever given.
Yes.
Which had evergreen on the side, which was really confusing.
Mm.
But it was full of Ultra Spire Zygos 4-packs.
Mm. And that's destined for Aotearoa.
Destined for Aotearoa. And that's why there's been a hold-up. I mean, you could make a comment on the fragility of global supply lines, but all we need to know is that there is a ton.
I'm doing jazz hands.
Jazz hands.
I'm excited.
Yep. Decimal point commas of Zygos 4s back in stock in the Ultra Spire store, and if you go to ultraspire.co.nz, you will find said pack, 14 litres, great for a day out, great for a big day in the hills, all the gear you need. Eugene and I both use them, and they're fantastic. Ultraspire.co.
With the little cell phone
with
patch.
With the cell phone pack,
pouch thing. Man, it's like having a little baby koala.
Yeah, less mucus. Less mucus, generally, than, you know, they don't have a quacker either, but just, they're good.
They're real good.
Ultraspire.co.nz.
Mm. The other thing that's real good, the Further Faster store in Christchurch.
They are bloody good. They just sponsored the Mount Oxford Odyssey, which turned on the weather. But
gosh, you needed some gear from Further Faster
absolutely.
For that race.
Montane gear. that looked really, really bad.
You could have carried a kayak on top of your head and pull that snow off.
Absolutely. If you had a dog with you, you could have kitted that dog.
Yes.
Rough rambling wear. Aside, they've got the best stuff.
They do.
And they really know said stuff, and they're passionate about said stuff. Mm-hmm. I understand they're getting the beer reviews back up and down, and they're an essential part of the community. So if you go to furtherfaster.co.nz, the best little independently owned outdoor store in Aotearoa.
Or if you're in Christchurch or Te Tahi, pop into the store and make sure you are singing this song.
It goes something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go further, faster now.
Church Radio.
This time I'll do the intro with the mic recording.
Should I hit record?
No, you good? Just did. Episode 142. We made it.
What'd you say? It's been a whirlwind.
It's been a whirlwind, yes.
Whirlwind. Big changes for you.
Yeah, well, I'm the only person on this podcast who hasn't paced road of a marathon this weekend. So, yeah, massive changes.
Well, no, you started a new job.
I did start a new job today, yeah. So I feel a little bit kind of... Put the things in the olive press and olives. And just squeeze. That's how I'm feeling right now.
You
but it's a great time.
Yeah.
And I mean, you seem remarkably relaxed and calm and cool and collected.
Oh, yeah.
You
were
out running. I had
a good time
on the weekend.
And got to see, I was down at Rotorua pacing the marathon for 4 hours and got to see plenty of people down there.
Yeah.
Rhys Johnston was on one of the aid stations.
Awesome.
Yeah. People like Mancini and Simon sorting out the paces, and I had a listener, Conrad Langridge, g'day. He, beforehand I caught up with him and he said he was aiming to smash 3:30. He'd been striving for it for a couple of years and he got there.
Awesome. 3:30 on Rotorua is no joke.
It is no joke. Yes, it's
not a flat course.
Yeah.
What's the elevation?
I'm not sure.
But around the
back.
Homerana.
Yeah, yeah, sort of between 20 and 27K, which is not a fun time of any marathon. And they just chuck some big hills in the middle of that. Anyway, it was great. It was a great weekend. And you got some amazing runs in.
Yeah, I had a good time.
I was quite jealous, actually. You sent me a picture before the Rotorua Marathon and you were on Tahinga and I was like, oh.
Well, I was like, oh, because I was kind of getting after my work, you know, and started early and the first half was dark and then by the time I got up the top of that kind of bluff, you know, the sun was coming, the light was overcast. I was like, oh, Eugene's running the marathon. I hope I haven't missed it. So, yeah. Flicked you a quick message of support because I had reception and it was...
And how was Tahinga?
It was mate. It was dry as. It was so dry. It was actually the driest I've ever run.
Because I thought it would have been really slippery.
I ran it a couple of years ago around this time.
Yep.
And because you got the sheep through there too.
Yeah.
And that middle third. So for those who don't know Tahinga, it's part of the Hillary Trail. And it goes from Tahinga or Bethel's Beach to Murawai. And it is 10K from gate to
roughly
thing.
Yeah.
And it's some of the most incredible running you'll ever see.
Yep. And we usually do an out and back, don't we?
Yeah. Do an out and back. Or you could go down to Murawai or you could go out the other way and you can kind of string it along. But it was fantastic. It was
great, dry.
Yeah. It was really calm. There was no one out on the trail that I saw at all.
Wow. Because in summer it can just get
It's like a super highway.
Yeah. Fantastic. And then you backed it up yesterday.
Yeah, backed it up yesterday. That's why I had to kind of put one leg up on a chair during our chat with Jaime Stevenson and talk about recovery. I'm a bit sore.
Yeah. So, yeah, we caught up with Jaime just now. Had a great conversation, which we will bring you with such delight because it's a great conversation. And so those of you who don't know, she's an ultra runner, a champion multi-day runner, a running coach.
Yep.
Been there, done that, and some great adventure races.
Absolutely.
Mm. And tons
mother of tiny humans.
Yes. Lived in Japan, came to New Zealand, fell in love with the country, spent some time in Australia. We'll forgive her for that. But here she is in Aotearoa. And I bumped into her at Rotorua. She was pacing the 4:30 group. You ran with her the weekend before.
Yeah. Oddly.
Yeah. So this is just, I think that should be the new standard for guests on DCR.
Pace Rotorua Marathon with you.
No. We catch up with them a couple of weeks. No, anyway.
It was great.
It was good fun. Yeah. And you had a good run with her. And so here she is on the show.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, soon. Right. Not right now.
No.
First of all, how have you been?
We talk about a lot about change, and the only constant is change. So after 3 years, I've moved away from my beloved emergency departments and started a new job today. And it's a lot to learn and there's a lot to go forward with. But
were you like the new kid at school not knowing where the toilets are and stuff?
I actually had to ask.
Where's the tuck shop?
No, they don't have a tuck shop. But Yeah, but I got a master key, see, so I can kind of go. So I spent, like, just opening doors all day. That's right. What I did. So yeah. What's in here?
Yeah.
Oh, pipes. Okay, classic. How are you?
I was pleased with how the basin duties went. I did feel this enormous responsibility just before it started. And there were so many decisions to make, you know, are you going to get gun time or mat time? Are you going to go by GPS or K markers? I was running with our friend Tom and we went with the traditional, you know, gun time and K markers.
Right.
But that left us with a bit of a dilemma because the K markers for the first sort of third of the race or so, we were behind.
Right.
Every kilometre, because we, you know, we knew roughly time was, well, we knew exactly. Tom knew exactly time-wise where we needed to be, Tom being Tom.
Did you have an auto lap on your phone? Or?
Yep. But that was running about 500 metres ahead and on my watch, yeah. And,
on your watch, sorry.
Yep. And we were ahead. We were so far ahead until suddenly we weren't. And then about halfway around, we were 3 minutes ahead of time without.
Oh.
Yeah, it was like, oops. But anyway, the hill sorted that out pretty quickly. and we got the job done and brought home a good-sized crew, and it was really pleasing and felt good to do that for people. And yeah, it was fun. It was fun. I really, really enjoyed it and would recommend it.
You looked you looked incredible coming over the line. You just kind of walked, like you'd walked around the block with a balloon tied to you. That's how you looked?
Well, you don't want to, I mean, you know, you don't want to be running your hardest for the pacing time that you're doing. Like if you were trying to set a PB pacing, that would be bad.
Yeah,
absolutely. So I was comfortable. I wouldn't say comfortable, but it wasn't, I was within myself.
Right, you'd run a marathon.
Yeah, I'd still run a marathon. Hell yeah, it was hard. Like people were saying, oh, this must be easy for you. It's like, no. It's not easy. You can't think of a marathon as easy.
Well, it's not an easy distance. It's not easy.
If you don't respect a marathon, it will kick your ass.
Yeah.
But certainly I you know, I wasn't foot to the floor or anything. And I just in that last couple of hundred metres, it was just so joyful because people were achieving their goal. Uh-huh. It was great. Yeah. So anyway, that's done and dusted. And now I'm looking forward to putting in a good solid block of work for W2K.
Yeah. That's feeling really real.
Yeah.
W2K is going to be great.
Yeah. Yeah. Bring it on.
Patreon patrons.
Yes.
We like you.
Yes.
If you like us,
yes,
we'd love you to come on board. Yes. If you set up a regular donation, cost of a cup of coffee a month or a one-off cup of coffee, help us to do things like get to W2K, put on live shows, put on other things that we've got in the pipeline, buy sound equipment, domain calls, costs, all those things, help us keep the lights on. Dirt Church Radio slash Patreon.
But there is a link on the website.
There's a link on the website. We're terrible business people. But anyway,
awful.
Let's crack on.
All right.
Glenn Sutton is incredible.
We should stand and salute.
That's right. We're standing now.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. Sounds to Summit. So Milford Sound to Aoraki Mount Cook along the road. Start out Thursday morning, finishing early afternoon Monday, about 580 kilometres and $15,000 for Otago Hospice.
At one stage, he'd been running for 75 hours and he'd only had three short sleeps totaling 75 minutes.
Oh my goodness. Glenn is an alumni of Dirt Church Radio.
Yes.
He's finished Badwater. He was the assist at the New Zealand Bigs. He's an all-round haunch. And we'll put a link up to his Give a Little page on our show notes for this. Amazing.
Yeah, and we look forward to hearing more about it. But wowza.
Speaking of people named Sutton.
Yes.
Tim Sutton.
Yes.
No relation.
No relation, presumably. Did you see his mission the other week? He rode his bike from Wellington Railway Station out to Rimataka Forest Park, ran, scrambled to the summit of Mount Matthews, which is the tallest peak of the range, back down, back on the bike, rode back to the road to the train station, 5 hours, 80 minutes, taking 7 minutes off the previous fastest known time. Boom.
Love it.
He's such a legend and just an adventurous.
I love stuff like that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
We go to that thing where you jump in an inner tube, tube around to my house.
Yeah.
Get out, mm-hmm. We run to the forest,
mm-hmm.
run for 12 hours. Uh-huh. I jump back in an inner tube, we catch the tide back to your house.
Uh-huh. Catch a fish.
Yep.
Oh, try and get the fastest known time.
That's right.
How come it took you 4 days? Couldn't catch a fish.
Fastest known tide.
Yeah.
100-mile treadmill world record by Taggart Van Etten, who ran 11:32.05 at a gastro pub in Illinois, as you do.
Yeah.
11:32 for 100 miles. I mean, talk about killing treadmills.
Yeah.
And Zach Bitter held the previous record of 12:09.15 from 2020. Mm. That's two world records he's lost in the past 2 weeks.
That's a world record.
Yep. That's a world record. It's like when all my world records went.
Yeah.
A record fell in Tennessee.
Yeah. So there's a bunch of excitement. A 30-year-old record was beaten by Zach Bevan in the Strolling Gym 40-mile race.
Yeah.
It's a 41.2-mile race. I don't know why they call it 40-mile. Anyway, 66 kilometres, which he won in 3:55.44, well under Andy Jones's 1991 time of 3:59.26. A 30-year record, which he set by running 3:36 minutes a K.
Wow. It's incredible. Kilometers. There's some people dropping some, and I don't know if it's because the States, it looks like perhaps that light at the end of the tunnel isn't a train.
Yeah.
But it might be the sun, but people are starting to come out and just get after it, right?
Mm, it's like they've been hibernating, haven't they? Sorry, yeah. I was off mic. They've been hibernating and doing some amazing things. Like, have you seen this from the BBC?
No.
So this Scottish woman, she's Anna Rutherford. She smashed the record time for the 212-mile Southern Upland Way by more than 17 hours.
Oh, God, I'm just reading ahead and I feel
she ate
sick.
Stock cubes.
Oh, my God. Was it like...
So she ran the coast-to-coast route from Port Patrick in the west to Cockburn Spath in the east. I messed that up, sorry, of Scotland. 62 hours, 34 minutes. She'd done it just 9 months after giving birth to her second child. And apparently ate stock cubes.
I think it would be probably called Coburn's Path.
Probably.
Like Coburn Street in Ponsonby.
Yeah.
Which is, we all know, Cockburn.
Yeah.
B, that's incredible.
Yeah.
C, I'm so curious as to what stock cubes they were. I hope they're just like the gnarly OXO bangers.
They would have been OXO, wouldn't they?
Hideous.
Hideous, hideous, hideous. Anyway, sorry, that's enough of big challengey things that were on the last week. But the other big, big, big news that came out during the week was this coming together of, are you still...
I'm still geeking out about the stock cubes. I love, people are people...
Maybe she made her own.
That would be cool. People are incredible. I was listening to a podcast on the way over here, a dude who made pemmican. Pemmican's like... If you had something that like Robert Falcon Scott used to try and get him to the South Pole.
Mm.
And it's like if you think about a muesli bar, but it was everything that bound the muesli bar together. So it had like a bit of fruit in it, but it was like mainly meat based. So it was like a tasty muesli bar or a one square meal that was held together with tallow and like ground up jerky and stuff.
Okay.
Pemmican.
Not tempted.
No, it's a bit meaty. But anyway, people are incredible.
Yeah, they are.
They make me laugh with joy.
They do. But look, the big news of the past week was this sort of partnership between UTMB and Ironman, who they've sort of got together and they're going to create a global series of races to qualify for UTMB and Mont Blanc. It sort of makes, there's these different series. It's a little bit complicated, to be honest.
I heard about it and I was like, I can't wait for Eugene to explain this to me.
Well, I'm going
to
try my best.
I also just, at the front, will Tom, do you reckon he'll get an Ironman tattoo on one calf and a UTMB one on the other, having done both?
No, apparently, I read in the fine print and you need an Ironman tattoo to enter UTMB.
That's sweet.
That's the way it is. Sorry. No, it's not really. But look, Tarawera is one of what are going to be called a World Series race. So is UTA, Ultra Trail Australia. But there are a bunch of other races that are going to be announced around the world that will serve as qualifiers, what they call World Series events, which replace the current Ultra Trail World Tour events.
Right.
You know those. So the World Series events like Tarawera will reward running stones to finishers, equivalent to one entry into the World Series finals lottery to get into UTMB. So
are they literal stones?
No, I don't think so. All right. Maybe. don't know. For the elites, they can race off for a spot at UTMB in one of three World Series majors, which are Continental Series finals in America, Europe and Asia, Oceania. They haven't said which races those are going to be yet. It kind of makes UTMB the Kona of mountain trail ultras, right, with elites and age groupers earning a spot. And there are still races to be added to the series, but there's been a strong reaction to it in the US, where there isn't much in the way of races on the calendar there yet.
Mm-hmm.
Partly people saying, get out, we don't want you. Partly people saying, what about us? But so that's going to be interesting to see how that develops. And people sort of saying, well, this was Ironman and UTMB's way of trying to get into the States. So look, you had people like Dylan Bowman and Lucy Bartholomew who'd been consulted before the announcement. They were talking very enthusiastically about it. But then there were others like John Kelly, who is not only an accomplished ultra runner, but he's also competed in Ironman, saying he was worried about the commercialization and monetization of the sport. One thing that was interesting is that ITRA, which is the International Trail Running Association, it's a non-profit that was closely aligned with UTMB, sort of, wasn't it? And they looked after the qualification points system for UTMB, which has now been replaced by this stones system, real stones or not, we're not sure. But anyway, they put out a statement themselves a couple of days before this big announcement. And so ITRA said they'd spent the past 12 months upgrading its systems to put what it hopes will be a one-stop shop for race organisers around the world, new technology platform for rankings and race listings, updated running performance index, and the formation of a medical and safety commission to provide advice to race organisers. So it's kind of like, is that going to be like an alternative to, you're going to have the ITRA-affiliated races and then you've got the UTMB Ironman races? You know, is it sort of, you're going to have the world split into two, as it were? The whole thing has kind of brought into focus the divide between America and Europe really sharply. I guess here we've seen what happens when Ironman comes on board. You know, they bought Tarawera off Paul Charteris and Tim Day. Sky hasn't fallen in so far, has it? You know,
no.
Look, yes, people say it's expensive, but hey, putting on multiple races over a very big course over a weekend is expensive. And there are plenty of the smaller boutique and not boutique, you know, races, which remain extremely popular. So it's not like Ironman via Tarawera has sucked the air out of trail running in New Zealand. So, you know, but let's wait and see.
Let us know your thoughts. I think as well, what need to consider is the Oceania Asian populate, like, us dudes and ladies and people at the bottom of the world. You know, there's a massive races happening in Asia.
Yeah.
Throughout the, you know,
and there were a few, the ones that were announced included ones in China and Thailand.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah, it's a big, big growth part of the racing world. So
let's see.
Let's see. It's a big, big power play. Yeah.
I still don't really understand it.
I don't, because they haven't made clear what what's what. I don't really understand it. And like, one sort of thing that I fundamentally don't understand is, does that make it easier or harder to get into UTMB? I don't know.
Well, I guess before as well.
Like, do you have to carry all the stones there?
But but there were points, right?
Yeah.
And part of the criticism with UTMB, and part of the criticism when some racers would say, no, stick your point system, was that it actually, they, it was a,
so Hard Rock, for instance,
they bought into it, so that you actually had to kick back to UTMB some money and they'd award you points. So yeah, gosh, I don't know.
Yeah
we'll but see. I think that the toothpaste is well and truly out of the tube in terms of commercialization.
Yeah, and that's true, but that doesn't mean that there's still not the small races.
No, at all. I mean,
and people in America have been pointing out that, look, you know, for instance, Western States, what do they have? How big's the field?
250, I think.
Yeah, 300 maybe. It's small, isn't it? Because of the restrictions that there are in place on fields, because they run through national parks and so on. So yeah, there's always been that tension. Well, since, what is it, 2003 that UTMB came along?
Yeah.
Where they just kind of have big fields, big, you know, big palaver, big festival, and Chamonix really turns it on and so on. But you know, Western States and Hard Rock and other races still have that prestigious feel to them, even though they have the smaller fields. So, you know, is this going to change that? probably not, but, you know, how, if you want to get to UTMB from the States, are you going to be able to do that now? Mm. Don't know. Yeah. Anyway.
369 people.
There you go.
Western States.
There you go. There you go. Right. There was some racing here in Aotearoa over the weekend.
Rotorua Marathon.
Yes.
First, Ingrid Cree from Wellington, 254.11. Second, Sue Crowley, Rotorua, 259.18. And third, Anna Williams from Rimiweta in Okalangi, 311.21.
And in the men, Michael Voss.
Boom.
229.29. Good ring to it, that as well. Greg Derbyshire from Auckland, 234.19. And Ewan Sinclair from Ellerslie, 234.36.
Right. And the half, it was Katie Whirl of Auckland, is it cleaner? Yeah. 132 flat, and Sewell's Corporal of Glacier in 1:12.28, proving that he can run just as fast on road as he can off it.
He sure can. He's got a decent marathon time too, isn't he?
Yeah.
Impressive beard too. Anyway, in the 10K, Hannah Gapes, Rotorua, 36.17, and Ian McDonald, also of Rotorua, 34.56.
So the South Island Ultramarathon,
yeah.
On the West Coast Wilderness Trail, the west coast of the South Island, looked like an incredible event. Started in Greymouth, around lakes and reservoirs, alongside streams, rivers, swing bridges, through a western town, wetlands, mountains, sea, a lot really, finishing at Hokitika.
Mm.
Incredible. In the 100K, it was Tony Smith, 10:14.44, Victoria Wiltshire in 10:28.48, and Heidi Rickard in 10:32.34.
And for the men, Daniel Cox, 8:21.45, Elliot Cree, 8:58.13, and Barney Hoskins, 9:01.13. Fun fact.
Yes.
Elliot Cree came second. He's the husband of Ingrid Cree, who won at Rotorua.
There we go.
Breaking rights to her this weekend.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, how'd you go? I came second. Wow.
My legs are sore. Oh, but did you run 100K? But it's easy to run. Anyway.
How'd you go? Oh, I came second. Well, I came first.
Yeah. In the 54 kilometres, it was Karis Tehu in 4:32.58 for first, and Chris Taylor 4:25.14 for first.
And in the 24K, Sophie Smith 1:52.09 for first, and Stuart Milne 1:35.01 for the men.
The Nugget was on Waihi, which is a classic. Starts at Waihi Beach. Some amazing single track, coastal native bush, lush farmland, and the running by the photo by the pit. Ooh, so good. It's a multi-sport event too, but in the 23-kilometre adventure run, it was Melissa McKinney, 2:18.03, Genevieve Fowler in 2:30.10, and Sarah Winter in 2:31.03.
And it's been a few weeks, but we are glad to welcome back David Hounschmidt, 1:46.04, Craig Fowler, 1:51.42, and Peter Connell, 2:11.51.
And David talked about the fact that he had to get up, race, win, quick bite to eat, and then off to the emergency department for a 9-hour shift.
Oh, really?
Yeah, what a haunch. What a centurion. Sure, well done, brother.
Yeah.
In the 10-kilometre run, it was cursed. In Montgomery in 46:46 and Tahuya Apapa in 43:35.
And in the 6K, Karenza Ali, 28:57, was first female and first overall.
Nice.
First male was Tyler Connolly, 29:19. He was in the year 6 and under category. Wow.
That's amazing.
That's so cool.
Waipukaro, Hawke's Bay Trail Run Series at Ranui Farm Park. The half marathon, it was Ryan Vining in 2:17.08, Sal Bredenkamp, 2:32.24, and Erlene Oldham in 2:37.29.
And the men, Dougie Kyle.
Oh, not just about the long stuff.
That's right, 1:48.12. Jamie Blakely, sorry, Jamie, 1:59.50, completely messed the whole thing up, 1:50.39. Tim Kershaw, 1:53.21. Yeah, good to see Dougie backing up from Relapse, Northburn, Tarawera.
Yeah, amazing.
Anyway, UTA on this week, Ultra Trail Australia. Ruth Croft lining up in the 50K. She'll be gunning for the course record, I'm sure. You've got Vlad Shatrov lining up in the 100K. He's never won that.
No.
But he'll be looking to emulate what he did at Tarawera 100 Mile last year.
Amazing. God,
I can't believe it was only last year.
No, you
feels
missed.
Like, well, it wasn't. It wasn't 2021.
Yes, it was last
2020.
Year.
2020.
Yeah.
And it feels like it was, you know, 100 years ago.
100 million.
Yeah. Anyway.
I was like, no, it can't be. Cause, yeah.
Because COVID.
Greatest run ever.
Greatest run ever. Greatest Run Ever, which is the part of the show where we ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be a run around the block, something that's sung to you for some reason, and you can send it in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And the beautiful thing about Greatest Runs Ever is if you've had a greatest run ever, you can have another one.
You can. You like this guy.
Brooke Van Rienen.
Hey.
You ever heard of him?
Brock.
Yeah, you have. Hey, guys, while I've already sent in a greatest run ever, yep, you have, I've had a fair amount of trail since, so I thought it might be time for an updated version. You don't really know when the great ones are going to come, but for me, this past April Easter weekend has just been the very top of that list. Runs don't get much better than our mission on the Milford Track in Fiordland National Park. It's regarded as one of the best hikes in the world, and it's always been on my to-do list, so I jumped at the chance when James Brewer invited me to tag along with 11 other close friends a couple of weeks ago. Arriving in Tiano on Friday, half of us went out for dinner and were told of Saturday's plans. Saturday rolled around and we all got in two vans at 6 a.m, which started the drive to Milford Sound, where we were going to catch a boat to our start at Sandfly Point. In most cases, it's the end of the walk, but as we were running, it's recommended to go the opposite direction so the hikers don't get annoyed. Excuse
good,
me, on your
good
left,
tip.
On your left. On your
passing, left. Passing, passing.
The drive into Milford is epic, but this time around it was dark. However, there was excitement all around as we drove into the Homer Tunnel, into the eighth wonder of the world. Oh, I've never been to Milford.
Oh, it's stunning.
Right, we'll go next time. Yep. We caught the boat at 8 a.m, which took about 15 minutes, and we were also differently paced, it was going to be hard to stay together. So the second boatload had the fast crew. Right, so it's people start, yeah, I get that. We took a few photos and then got stuck into warm-up just as the sun started coming up on a cold, crisp, bluebird Fiordland day.
Whoa.
Yeah, it sounds like they lucked out with the weather, and we couldn't have had a better day. As we got going, the groups quickly separated, and soon enough I was cruising by myself until I caught up with Rachel Bridgewater and James Brewer. As we passed the highest waterfall in New Zealand, which is the Sutherland Falls, we didn't make the side trip because we only had a 10-hour window. But before, we had to get to the other side to get our boat back to Tiano Downs, so we thought there wouldn't have been enough time. We then started the climb up to McKinnon Pass, where we were rewarded by some of the best views that we'd ever seen. As a cold wind blew on the tops, we didn't hang around long and started the 25-kilometre descent to Glade Wharf. That sounds amazing. After splitting my knee open earlier in the year on the heafy, these days I'm a lot more careful on the rocky stuff, so took it easy and eventually made my way down. By this stage, I was by myself and about 40 kilometres deep heading into a hot afternoon. Eventually, I caught up with James and Rach and was feeling good, so passed them. More often than not, seeing on these big missions, I hit a wall, and it's hard to get back into a nice rhythm once that happened. But this time around, I was having an awesome day out there, and everything seemed to click. The scenery probably had something to do with that. Gradually, I made my way along the Clinton River to Glade House, a normal start of the Great Walk. Soon enough, Rach and James caught up to me. We ran the last kilometre to Glade Wharf, where our water taxi was waiting for us after a 56-kilometre, 8.5-hour day. We were the first to arrive, so hung out with the sandflies and waited for everyone else. In hindsight, we could have visited the falls, as half the group did, but hindsight is always 20/20. It is always 20/20.
Yeah.
Everybody gradually arrived, some more broken than others, and as the sun started to set, we made our way across a bumpy Lake Tiano back to our vehicles, which had been relocated to Tiano Downs, where it was a short 20-minute drive back to reality. Running through iconic Fiordland bush next to giant waterfalls surrounded by giant mountains, it's going to take a lot to top that bucket list stuff. Right up there as my greatest run ever.
Wow, Brooke.
Amazing.
That certainly earned a second greatest run ever. Thank you so, so much.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Incredible, incredible. The rest of you, send them in. We love them.
Yeah, please do. They're right. Really, really cool. People love reading them. Right, on with the show. Jaime Stevenson is incredible. I met her a couple of weeks ago when I was clear bowled over by her energy, as she was the first person with her tent at the Riverhead Backyard Relapse. She is an incredible competitor. She's a coach. She is a friend, she's a pacer, she's a mother, she's
adventure racer,
multi-day stage person, Marathon Des Sables, Marathon Des Sables alumni, Alps to Ocean winner, and all-round just beautiful human being, really. So without further ado, here's our conversation with Jaime Stevenson.
Dirtchurch Radio.
So all the way from Derry Flat, we are joined by Jaime Stevenson. Jaime, kia ora, how are you going?
Yeah, I'm good, very good. How are you guys doing?
I'm really well. I feel like I'm a little bit of the odd one out here because I'm not in the 2021 Rotorua Marathon Pacers Club, like you two are.
It was good fun, wasn't it?
It was a really good experience. It's probably one of my favorite road marathons in New Zealand.
Yeah.
It's just that every year you sort of go and it's an annual catch up with the people that do the marathons. And
yeah.
Yeah.
You love pacing, don't you? You've done it quite a few times.
Yeah, I started pacing, 7 years ago. So Rotorua was my first marathon that I paced for. I sort of wanted to start pulling back from racing, and I wanted to get into giving back a little bit more. And somebody said, well, why don't you do some pace running? So I looked into it, and I got in contact with a guy called Simon Clendon, who was organizing pace running.
The legend,
back then. And yeah, and I just did the five-hour pacing that year. And then I just went on to Auckland Marathon, and so I paced there as well too. So I've done a few half marathons, Kirikiri half marathon, but every year I go back to Rotorua. So
yeah.
It's such a
special event, isn't it, Rotorua?
Yeah. It's just the way you go around the lake and you sort of go around the back part, and it's just so pretty in there.
Mm.
And it's such a pretty time of year as well too, with the trees and the colors. A very, very special event.
And you were both talking before how it's special too that, you know, we talk about pacing and traditionally sort of trail and ultra marathon terms, but I mean, I guess it originated on the road, and it's such a it's an incredible job that you have. Like, it's your part timepiece, part coach, part counselor.
Yeah.
I remember the first marathon that I ever did. I got my PB on that marathon, and it was in the Gold Coast. And it was the first time I'd ever sort of heard of pace runners or have come across pace runners. And it was this old guy, and he must have been in his late 70s, and his name was Skin and Bones.
Wow.
He was just a machine, and he just talked the whole way through it. And he just sort of, he's like, all right, here's a little bit of a rise, and just keep your cadence going. And all right, everybody have some water. And I was just so inspired how somebody could actually run and talk and guide while getting me through a friggin' half-hour marathon. So that was sort of my first experience.
Yeah, yeah.
With pacing. Just even the last 7 years, people that I've had the pleasure to pace with, like a lady named Kiri Price, we set a tradition that every kilometer marker, we'd see the kilometer marker, and we'd be like, all right, guys, 3, 2, 1, yay! And we jump over the kilometer marker. And everybody thinks this is great fun up until about kilometer 32.
Yeah.
Yay, the only one going over the kilometer. But your enthusiasm sticks with them. So people come up to you often and go, oh, thanks for your enthusiasm. And thanks for all your words and for helping me out. So it's a very rewarding job.
It was the first time that I've done it formally. I've paced for people, you know, friends and so on before, and paced at Tarawera which is a different role altogether.
You had a little caravan there. You're supposed to be one person. But
this is the first time I've done it kind of formally. I was so nervous. I felt like I just had this immense responsibility on my shoulders. Pardon?
You didn't show any nervousness. You had confidence about you.
No, that's the thing. When you I mean, Rebecca talks about the fact that when Eugene was training for the Tarawera 100 mile, he spent this 12 hours out at Riverhead that time. And Rebecca ran into you in like the last bit.
I was finishing.
You're finishing. And my wife was like, oh, have you just been out for a 5K run or something like that? Like, you just, I don't know what it is, man. You didn't swagger across, but you just kind of came across really confidently, looked super relaxed. Amazing. I envy it so much. Absolutely.
You gotta put a front on sometimes, don't you?
Exactly. So you say things with conviction and anybody will believe it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I heard someone say that. I was listening to a podcast the other day when I was running, and he's an American chap. His name's Chad Wright, I think his name is. He's done attempted the Revenant. And he said that he will never, even if he's feeling terrible and in the worst state of his life, like if he's dragging himself along by his hands, he'll never actually utter the words that he's feeling bad. Like if someone goes, how are you going? He'll go, I'm outstanding.
I remember once coming up Moria Hill in Rotorua, and I thought I had said something in my head which apparently had come out of my mouth because people sort of looked at me and I was like, oh no, I actually verbalized that, which...
What'd you say?
Betrayed me. I said, whose stupid idea was this?
Oh, right.
Ooh, did the F word come out?
Yeah. But I thought, I seriously thought I just said it to myself, but yeah, trying to portray this sort of, you know, confidence and stuff, and we're okay, but no.
Did you keep it going? Were you like, well, got away with that one, Bingham. Fantastic. They'll never know.
No one will ever know. Yeah.
Nobody heard it.
Yeah. As you were. But that wasn't this year, I'm hastened to add.
No, that's right.
I was encouraging people up Moria Hill.
And that's the other thing with pacing is that you sort of, it takes away from your own distractions or discomfort, and you sort of, it gets placed on trying to help the people. So I find that it's as uncomfortable because you're constantly worrying about what everybody else is sort of doing and encouraging people. And
yeah.
So you don't, yeah.
Now, Jaime, I mean, you have turned kind of, I guess, encouraging and having worrying and concern about people into a full-time job. You're a running coach.
I am, yes. I started my business back in 2014. And basically it sort of started off working with sort of half marathon and road runners, because that's sort of my major background is road running. I'm a bit of a diehard roadie, but I'm working my way into trails. I'm becoming comfortable in trails. And then about probably 2 years into coaching, I started training more trail runners. And then after I went to Marathon Des Sables in 2014, I came back and there seemed to be somewhat of a need for multi-day trainers, coaches. And I sort of fell into that niche for a while. So that's sort of where I'm sitting at the moment, is sort of multi-day and ultra running.
Wow.
Yeah. What is the difference in what are the different needs for a multi-day event that you don't get if you just train for a quote-unquote normal event?
First of all, there's gear. So depending on what the event is, so multi-day races are classified between supported and unsupported. So if you're going into a race like Marathon Des Sables, which is unsupported, you're carrying everything on your back for the duration of the run. And once you get into an unsupported race, you have to look at weight pack, making sure you're training sort of with your pack, all your gear. You sort of want to go as lightweight as possible. And then you can look at the other category, which is supported, where the race organizers actually carry your gear for you from day to day. So then you don't have to get it's not as critical getting lightweight gear. But then you have to get into nutrition. The biggest thing with multi-day running is recovery. So it's one thing I sort of work a lot on with my multi-day runners, is making sure recovery is king. You get back into, you know, within 5 kilometers of getting to that finish line, you should be thinking about getting your recovery drink in you. And it's just all just recovery, recovery, recovery. Eat, and then legs up, rest. So, yeah, so there's a lot more to the planning side of it compared to ultra running, which is sort of anywhere from 1 to 2 days.
Mm.
And then, I mean, obviously you deal with nutrition and recovery in a different way.
Mm. It seems like you'd need to be so much more disciplined with your recovery, wouldn't you? Because, I mean, people talk a big game about being disciplined with their recovery from a trail and ultra running perspective, but I've just seen everyone kind of go a little bit apeshit really after they finished. They're like Pringle or whatever, you know, they're like, yes, let's go.
Well, from a coaching point of view, I'm quite particular with the way people recover, because if they can recover, then I can stress. And I'm always that's what I say my job is I find a way to stress you, or I stress your muscles. And if I'm able to stress you better, then you can perform better. If you're not getting into your recovery and you're starting a hill session with lead legs, then you're not going to get the stress that I need to see. So yeah, so recovery is sort of king with training. So
I mean, we touch on it in so many different forms, but recovery is a consistently kind of, it seems like it's so contextual in terms of where the sport is and where we have the ideas, you know, like I heard from Like Luke McCallum last week, he was saying just put your feet up on your, not, you know, like rest as much as you can versus taking an active recovery approach or a balance of two, and different things work for different people. It's so individualized, isn't it?
Oh, it's, yeah, it's very individualized. And sort of the biggest thing with recovery as well too is just making sure you're sort of onto it quite quickly. So if you have a big training session, you've got a small window of when you can sort of get back into your muscles the glycogen that you need to use or to store as energy for the next session. And there's a lot of recovery drinks out there that sort of work with a carbohydrate protein ratio that will give you enough carbohydrates to store in your muscles so that you can build the energy up and be recovered. So
what do you like at recovery?
Oh, I'm good. I'm really particular. I like to train big. So to me, I like big training weeks. Because I'm a mother of two, my recovery, as in downtime from training, is normally during school holidays. So that's sort of when I go, all right, I've got 2 weeks. I've got sort of eight to 10 to train. And then I take the 2 weeks full recovery.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm quite particular with massaging and rolling. And I got a massage gun just recently, which is great for trigger points. And making sure I've got to do yoga and stuff like that as well too, to my training.
Now, you described yourself as someone who has traditionally had more of an affinity for the road. However, it's weird. Like we were saying before we started, Eugene and I both met you on two consecutive runs in the course of a week, one on trail, one on road. But, I watched you at, the backyard relapse on an incredibly challenging, course and incredibly challenging conditions. What drew you to what drew you to the relapse?
Where should I start? I went on a journey for quite some time about multi-day running, and I loved multi-day running, but I got to a point where I decided to hang up my multi-day running shoes for a while. And I decided I wanted to try to start to push my distances. And leading up to that, I submitted my registration for Spartathlon, which is a race in Greece that goes from Sparta to Athens. In order to do that, I had to qualify to get into it. And then I had to put my name into the ballot. Anyways, long story short, I got the spot. And here I was giving this
chat. Gee, Jamie, what happened?
Covert game. And I wasn't able to go and do it. So when that happened, I thought, no, I still want to see how it feels to run longer distances without sleep. So multi-day running, you always sort of run the distance, you get to camp, you recover, you sleep, you go again. I wanted to move into the next area of my running, and I wanted to go longer without sleep. So my step into Spartathlon was pretty big. And then sort of the letdown of not being able to do it was pretty big. So then I decided to go to the track, and I did the 24-hour track. And my goal was to get 200 kilometers, and I got 164 kilometers in, and yeah, my body just had a bit of a meltdown, and I couldn't push on. So I decided to go into the relapse to again try to get the 200 kilometer marker. That was my goal. And to break through a few mental barriers as well too, because I've got this thing about Riverhead that I'm quite nervous going into Riverhead by myself, I guess. Just being a female going in there by myself, I was always quite nervous, even though it's so close to my home. I was always just a bit apprehensive about dogs or just being in there by myself. So for me, Riverhead was a massive step, going in there, forcing myself to go in there, you know, every day when I was training big, and just to get the kilometers under my legs. And I loved it. Like I had the best build up for Riverhead. I had so much fun training out there, and I really fell in love with it. I'm really enjoying my time out there now, which is awesome.
That's so good.
And the other thing was at the 24-hour track event, I sort of, my brain went on me a little bit, and I got into quite a negative headspace, which I've never done before with any of my events. And it sort of stuck with me of why I got into that negative headspace. And it was like, oh, boo-hoo, poor me. And I've never been like that before. So I wanted to test Riverhead to see if that was something that I was going to have to deal with moving forward with my bigger distances. And I was very happy that, you know, to finish the race and to be as happy as I did. And I was positive the whole time, even when it was freaking, the mud was there and the rain was there. I called myself a few times going, this mud, but I didn't. I was like, I pulled myself out of it. And I was like, come on, Jamie, just keep going. Remind yourself, where are you? I'm in the forest. This is amazing. Yes, it's muddy, but that's okay.
I mean, I can attest to that, Stoke, because when we turned up, so what happened is my whānau and I, we had a camper van, right? So we rolled up in this camper van and we've got the key to the forest, sweet as. You've got to go through two lock gates, sweet as, up the thing. Get there on the Thursday afternoon, there's a tent. There's a tent there. We're like, God damn it, like, there's a tent. Someone beat us to it again. There's a tent there. And it was Jamie's tent.
She'd, I was really nervous. I had to get things set up.
And got the prom position, like the best position. It wasn't too close to the genies. It wasn't, you know. And then I
have to be too cheeky with it. I thought, oh, shit.
I think,
just move it as close as possible to the trees.
And then you rolled up on us and super positive, like super positive. And then started super positive. And then when you finished, and I mean, that was how it was dark, wasn't it? It was around just over the 100K mark, was it?
Yeah, yeah. So it was the 14th loop when the rain hit.
Yeah, and you timed out like a minute or two, wasn't it?
Yeah, because I fell down. There was that one section, that death climb, that cliff death climb, yeah, I slid backwards, and I was laying in the bushes, looking up at the forest sky with the rain coming down on me, questioning life choices of what I was doing out here at 4 o'clock in the morning. I was like, no, come on, get up. So I rolled myself up and I sort of climbed up this death climb. And I got to the top and I sort of looked at my watch and it was 24 minutes in. And I just knew that I wasn't, as hard as I could push, I wasn't going to make the climb.
Right, so right.
Let's just enjoy the last loop. So I got in at 99 kilometers and then I went and ran another 1 kilometer to make it 100. So
fantastic. I mean, and yeah, so that I can attest to that positivity was there right throughout the whole thing.
Yeah.
And you had a cool little group with you too. You had Simon and a bunch of other people, and they'd certainly been getting their cheer on for a while, I think, hadn't they?
Did you?
Yeah. Well, all those people that just sort of they're the reason. I mean, the first time I ran an ultra marathon, I asked Simon, I was like, so if there was an ultra marathon that you would run, which one would it be? And he said, oh, go do Hutt River. So he's like, yeah, who I look up to. And my other girlfriend, Tracy Benjamin, she's done Costa Causey and all sorts of other crazy events. And so they know what supporting means and they just love being a part of it.
What a great crew. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 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 Pretty special.
Did you employ any sort of special tactics or anything to be able to deal with those negative thoughts that you felt at the 24-hour event to be able to help you at Riverhead? Was there anything in particular that you did that might be helpful to people to understand?
Yeah, so I read this book by Kerry Evans, and it's called Performing Under Pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And what he does is he gave me a tool that when you feel pressure means you have fear inside of you. So for me, the fear was the mud or the slipping and falling or tripping. So anytime that you sort of feel that adrenaline or you feel that nausea of pressure, he said, what you have to do is you have to visualize a stick, and the stick is made up of a red side and a blue side. And he sort of gets into what the red side, meaning the red side of the brain, which is your sort of your primal part of the brain where you feel fear. And then the blue side of your brain is where you think logically and you have goal setting. And so when you feel the adrenaline or the fear or the pressure, you have to sort of visualize the stick and see where you are. Or more red or more blue. Most of the time for me, it was more red. And then what you have to do is you have to picture, and it sounds all quite weird, but if you read the book, it makes a lot of sense.
Sure.
You picture a picture frame around your stomach, a red picture frame. And then you have to be able to look into the picture frame to see different perspectives to make the picture frame grow. So for example, Mia's going, ugh, the mud. I don't know if I'm going to make it the next lap. I don't want to do the death climb again. All of a sudden I'm in the red brain, where I just kept going, no, but Jaime, you're in the forest. You have 59 minutes to do this. You can walk this part. You're in the forest. Yes, it's raining, but it's really cool out here, and you've got this head torch. And so you're looking at it from different perspectives, and all of a sudden the pressure eased and you're like, ah, cool. And then you carry on until you sort of start feeling it again. And it was just time and time again. I just kept going, argh. And then you're like, no, I'm going to not go, oh, poor me, boohoo, it's muddy. You just go, no, I'm just going to see it from a different angle and keep doing that. And it really helps. So yeah, I found the book was very, very, very helpful.
It's really, because you know, it's not like you're ignoring those fears or you're acknowledging them. Because that's another way of doing it, but it's never very successful, is it? Just try and black it out,
Wait it. You just push it push it down. It'll go. And
I can't see you. I can't see you.
Keep pouring water into the cup.
But that's,
health professional, that's my advice. Just run through it. No, sorry.
Hang on.
Matt Raymond says... It's actually
anybody's looking at trying to work on their mental state while running, I found it invaluable. It's probably one of the best tools I've come across.
And there is a certain amount of when you actually, because that's the thing, isn't it? When you sit back and you consider, there is a certain amount of, I mean, there's looking at that kind of like, don't be a whatever, normally kind of misogynistic adjective or whatever about it. Push it down, but actually, if you can, it's sitting with that emotional state, isn't it? Like, and that actually is kind of saying, okay, this is happening. It's not going to kill you. It's not going to.
And then you look at it from the different angles. Yeah. You sort of go, well, what else can you say? You go, well, it's just a race, or you have the time, or your training's been fantastic for it, and you're out in the forest, and you're comfortable out in the forest now, and you sort of highlight all the cool things that are happening.
Yeah, a bit of perspective.
Yeah, different perspectives, exactly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, taking it back, and I guess this is kind of germane, where did your running journey begin? Were you a born runner, or is it something you picked up later?
No. I was a bit of a chunky monkey after university, and I needed to lose some weight. So I jumped onto a treadmill.
What did you study at university?
English literature.
Wow.
Yeah. So I was a teacher, and I moved to Japan, and I was teaching over there. And that's actually where I started running when I was living in Japan. And I didn't run outside because I was very self-conscious about running outside. So there was a gym, local gym. So I started running there. And I remember sort of running for a minute and wanting to die and going, why do people do this? This is horrible. But I was persistent with it. And so after about 8 months, I lost about 10 kilos, and I probably stuck to running just to keep the weight off, and it made me feel really good. And I sort of ran for anywhere between 30 to 40 minutes every day or every second day. And then I moved to New Zealand, and again, I stopped running, probably due to my relationship with my ex-partner. We just, running wasn't seen as a priority. And then him and I ended up breaking up about two years after that. And again, I'd sort of piled on some weight and drinking and party. So it was, time to put on my running shoes again. And that's when I really fell in love with running. And that was back in 2005. So I started doing half marathons. I started running outside. And sort of starting to discover New Zealand in a completely different way. 2006, I went over to Australia and I did my first marathon.
Wow. That's a quick kind of transition.
Yeah, it was really quick, considering it took, it was 2 years of running on a treadmill for 30 to 40 minutes to half marathon to marathon very quickly. I did quite a few marathons in New Zealand and in Australia. My husband and I moved to Australia. So I did a few marathons over there, Great Ocean Road, Brisbane. So just again, road running. I never heard of these things called trail running. Mm-hmm. Never even heard of it. And then moved back to New Zealand and had my bubbas. So I had my first bubba over in Australia. And then once my second bubba was born, I decided to pick things up a little bit. So my first 60 and did it 67 and sort of just started increasing from there. So, and then once I turned 40, my birthday present for my 40th birthday was the entry into Marathon Des Sables.
Wow.
So, wow.
Yeah, it was a race that I still remember watching on a TV show when we were living in Australia. And I just remember looking at it going, this is the craziest thing I'd ever seen in my entire life. I was just blown away by it all. But it stuck with me and it stuck with me and it stuck with me. So for my 40th, I just said, you know, it was what, 8 years later, I said to my husband, I said, I need to do this race now.
Yeah.
He said, yeah, we'll make it happen. So, and that just changed things in a whole different way. So
it's something that it's interesting, isn't it? Like a race will grab you by the proverbial scruff of the neck and give you a bit of a shake. Eh? Some do, some don't.
Mm.
You know, have you had a race like that, Eugene?
There's an event. I think there's some events that just stick with you, and you kind of think about them, think about them, think about them, and then it's just like I'm either going to do it or I've just got to stop thinking about it, isn't it? So that with you, that's what kind of where it got to.
Was it was just always there. Anytime I'd heard, it was just the most. It was the most ludicrous, craziest, most adventurous race I'd ever seen. It was. Yeah. It just blew my mind.
Was it because it was in the desert?
Yeah. Yeah, it was in the desert, and it was self-sufficient, and just the way the camps were set up, and the sand, the color of the sand was just, it was everything and more. It was still, in my eyes, the most beautiful race in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how was the expectation versus reality?
It was insane. Like, yeah. You know, they picked you up in these buses and you were in, you know, these big, massive buses, white, clean buses driving through these towns through Morocco and all these kids coming out to see these buses come through. It was like you were a bit of a movie star. And then you got to camp, which was an 8-hour bus ride into the middle of the Sahara Desert, and they dropped you off. And there was like this camp that was set up where they had these medic tents and this food hall and then your tent, and then you got to your tent and it was just this like this stick holding up this tarp. It was a bivouac of sorts, and yeah, it was everything and more. The race was, I felt really prepared for the race. I trained about 18 months for it, so I felt really really prepared going into it. Again, I was absolutely obsessed with getting it right. Made some lifelong friends doing it. It was just incredible. Long stage was 80 kilometers of soft sand.
Wow.
And I remember coming to the finish line, and I was running through, and with the event they have this light that they shine up into the sky, and apparently they can see it from like the moon, or they can see it from outer space or whatnot. It's like this massive light that comes into the sky, and you're running along, and you come up to the top of this hill, and you look down and you can see the light.
Wow.
And I got so emotional that I just started crying. And I knew it was about another 5K soft sand to get to the finish. And I remember just running and running and running and running. And at the end of every stage, they had a little webcam, and you could talk into the webcam. So I knew my boys would be at the end waiting to see me come through. And I came through, and it was like, I had just conquered the world. I was so full of emotion and pride. And I came through, and there was like, came through the finish line, and there was like three flashing lights, and there was nobody there. Like there was nobody there. It was like midnight. There was nobody there. There was one person with a little marker marking your name off of. And I just felt like I had just conquered the world, and there was nobody to celebrate with me. So I just sat there and I cried for a few minutes. And then I remembered my boys were at the end on the video, on the cam. And so I went over and I said, I love you boys. And then I went off and cried. And yeah, it was a very emotional event. Cause I think a lot of hurdles I got through to get there and the training and all of that. So it was very good. It was very emotional. So from there, I was pretty much hooked on multi-day running.
It's almost a purer, a purer way to express that triumph, isn't it? That when you get somewhere, like it's so easy to be swept along. You get there and everyone's like, you're the best, Matt or Eugene or Jamie, like, well done. And then you actually have to sit, again, you sit with that emotion of like what you've achieved. There's a dude with a checkboard. I'm sure he was very pleasant, but he's got a job to do.
You're coming through your miler and you've just conquered the world, right? Like you're just so full. And then there's just like three flashing lights. And you're like, there is everybody.
Yeah. Amazing. Oh, gosh. Just fantastic. And look, talk us through Spartathlon sounds like one of the pure, for those who don't know, one of the sort of purest sort of expressions of difficulty out there.
Yes. So getting into it was really hard, as in I had to qualify, get my qualifying race, submit it, and to actually get the spot was pretty special. So I was the only female in Australasia that got the spot.
Wow.
And unfortunately, just with their rules and restrictions, I have to go through the process again in order to do it. And it's one of those races again that I know is in there. I know I'll get to the start line one day. I just have to make sure that I'm fresh enough to do it. So it's a brutal race. Two-thirds of the field get DNFs because of the time cutoffs. So they have aid stations. Quite often there's lots and lots of aid stations. So you have to be able to do your first cutoff is the marathon, which is 4.5 hours. So you have to do it in 4 hours, which is very doable, but you have to still be able to run. The last big cutoff is the miler right before you hit. So at the miler marker, you hit a climb, which is 1,000 meters of climbing. And getting to that aid station, I think it's 22 hours or 20, maybe 24 hours. It's very, very, very quick. Anyway, so you have to be moving at an average of around 7:30. In order to get
so it's like 238 kilometers, is it?
246
kilometers. Wow. Yeah.
And you got a 36 hour cutoff.
Mm.
So,
and it's road,
yeah,
isn't it?
Predominantly road. Yeah. There are a few areas that are sort of muddy tracks. But yes, predominantly road. So again, that was another reason for me.
Yeah.
Sort of my happy place is doing that.
And are you, are you running through towns or in villages or?
Yeah, there's heaps of different villages and towns and stuff like that.
Mm.
And then you've got your crew as well too, sort of. And the aid stations are very frequent. You know, they're every sort of 3-4 kilometers. I think there's 75 stations.
Wow.
Yeah,
I remember reading a book about it called Why We Run. It's actually my favorite running book. A guy named Robin Harvey, he set out to do it. And it's a British author, and I was just into, I got it from the CUMU library, and I read this book. It was one of the bleakest things I've ever read. He DNFs,
right.
Spoiler alert. Sorry, Robin. I remember just thinking, my goodness me, the difficulty of it. And like 12-hour night, and the process that he went through. How did you train for, how did you go about adapting your training to train for something that's like, just the 250?
Well, the first thing I did is I hired a coach. So I was lucky enough when I did a race in Fiji called the Lost Island Ultra.
Uh-huh.
And again, it was a multi-day race that went from one side of Viti Levu, which is the main island in Fiji, to the other side. And in the race, the race director was this beautiful lady called Mimi Anderson. And I don't know if you know or heard of Mimi Anderson, but she's, have a look one day. So she's done the Spartathlon Traverse. So she's gone there and back. She's done double comrades. She's incredible. So I had the pleasure of spending six days with her in the headlands of Fiji, which was amazing. And so, so I contacted Mimi and asked her if she could coach me for it. But because, again, I had just got back from Alps to Ocean, and I got news that I got the spot, and all of a sudden COVID was here. So we didn't really know how it was going to be.
Right.
working or training wise. So for her, she said, well, let's just work on speed work right now. So we wanted to just try to get my marathon time down to sort of that 3:30, 3:45. So that was sort of our first goal. And then unfortunately things just sort of turned to custom.
And do you, notwithstanding the disappointment of what happened last year, do you still have the bug?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I shouldn't have said have the bug. That was actually bad in a COVID world. That was, sorry. Do you still want to do?
I'm going to go back to the track in September, and I'm going to try and get my qualifying time through the 24-hour track. So that's 170 kilometers within the 24 hours. So I wasn't too far off last time. So I just want to get get the qualifying time again, because I have to redeem the qualifying time. And they're not accepting anything under 120 kilometers or 120 kilometer race now at the moment. So I'll do my 24 hour track.
Yep.
And then I'll go through the process of applying for it again.
Are there other things you have to do as well? Like,
it's a full resume.
Right.
Yeah. So there is a full resume of, they just want to know that you're legit. And you're not going to hurt yourself. So you just have to submit a full resume. Yeah.
So with your history of multi-day races and so on, you've got the experience, and they know you can do it, but you still need to have that qualifying time, as it were, or race. Right.
And I mean, they only, you know, we're quite lucky here in New Zealand. There's only a few people who sort of submit their names for it. But, you know, over in Australia, I've got a good friend of mine there, and she's been trying for years to get into it, and she just can't secure her spot for it. And a girlfriend that I actually met, she's living here in New Zealand, but she's from Spain, and she got a spot for the same just this past year, and again she wasn't able to do it, and her chances of actually being able to get a spot again are, it's just not going to happen. So she's going to have to win a ticket, and to win a ticket you have to be fast.
Do they offer tickets, or not offer them, but are there places available geographically or anything? Like, they're sort of...
Yeah, so there's a certain amount of... So they take one person from New Zealand, one person from Australia, I think there's only like 300 spots or something throughout the world. You know, four or five people maybe from Canada, maybe five from the States. So it's very small numbers. Take probably more Greeks, and I think it's Japanese. They take quite a high amount of Japanese runners too.
So do you push your time in Japan to get the double, the New Zealand and the Japanese? I did live in Japan, so can I?
Yeah. The Canadian and the New Zealand.
and you were down to do it before, so come on, please.
So no fun. No, definitely still have the desire to go.
Yeah.
To go. It's one race that's sort of on my top list of events.
Yeah.
Since COVID and being a coach, have you noticed, and now that in Aotearoa we're kind of, it's still there, right? It feels like it's
an ever-present threat.
It's almost at the end, it's always at the edge of the campfire light, right? You're kind of like shining the torch. Has people's approach to events and coaching changed over the course of COVID, and do you see it sort of differently than, say, a year ago?
I wasn't really, luckily, really affected. My business wasn't really affected when it hit. There was a lot of disappointment with events being cancelled, and a lot of people training, you know, they'd spent the last year training towards a, you know, Northburn, for example, and that got cancelled. And so there was quite a few, but people's spirits lifted quite quickly. Like, I don't think people just sort of runners just went, oh, okay, well, let's just find the next one. And so I've got this base fitness or whatnot. There were a few of my people who did marathons in their back gardens during lockdown. They're like, oh, we're supposed to be doing Rotorua Marathon. I was like, well, let's just go do Rotorua Marathon. So my husband and I ran two marathons in our garden. so that sort of kept the spirit going. But, you know, I've picked up a few more runners than I normally do, especially because people could get into running. I can actually run. It's one thing that they could do. And all of a sudden they sort of like, oh, I actually quite like this running thing. And, oh, let's just enter an event. And, yeah, so things have sort of picked up a little bit afterwards.
Rotorua at the weekend had its biggest field for years, wasn't it? Across all the events, not just the marathon, but which you've got to think that's partly probably thanks to COVID.
Yeah. Mm. People are wanting to get out and to celebrate and to be part of events and part of the community. And they
discovered running.
Yeah, and have discovered running. Yeah, and I think a lot of people discovered running when they were in lockdown. Mm. Was one thing that
I thought I was quite tolerant, but I found myself sort of like skewing quite NIMBY at times during level 4. I'd be out on my trails, not my trails, the trails that I ran on. I'd be like, what are you up to? It's Tuesday. It's normally.
What are you all doing here?
Me.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's wonderful. It's actually wonderful to see people enjoying trails. I mean, how much of you've been very open. And you've been very open, you know, on your website. You were open when we had a run together and we were talking about sort of mental health issues that have been challenged by in the past. How much of coaching would you say is I'm trying to put this in a way that makes sense.
Do I bring into my coaching?
Sorry?
How much of it do I bring into my coaching?
Yeah.
So basically after I had my second son, I went through, when I was pregnant with my second son, I was about 28 weeks pregnant. I got anxiety,
right?
Like really severe anxiety where I was, in to see maternal mental health, for quite a while. And they got me stabilized with drugs through the later part of my pregnancy. After I had my son, I sort of went off medication with the advice of my doctor, and quite quickly after that, things escalated again to a point where I just wasn't sleeping, you know, for days at a time. I think my longest stretch was 8 days with no sleep.
Oh my goodness.
It was about five years of dealing with mental health and medication and all of that side of things. But through that process, I experienced a lot of I grew a lot, obviously. So I learned a lot about the mind. I learned a lot about cognitive behavioral therapy. I learned a lot just about not rushing things, staying in the moment, staying in the present. And I think it's something that I see quite a bit is people dealing with anxiety or people dealing with depression. I dealt with all of my issues through exercise. So I ran, and my husband was very supportive with me. And, you know, he'd get home and the baby would be screaming and the 2-year-old would be running around, and he'd just grab them and just go run. Just go run. And I'd come back, and everything, obviously, with everything that happens, all the good hormones that are produced while running, I came back and I was just a more relaxed, calm person. So I deal with people who have high stress jobs or have anxiety, have depression. It's quite common to deal with. So I think I can bring a lot of my past into coaching, and I work with small numbers as well too. So I only take max 25 clients a year. A lot of my clients I've had for 6 years. So I'm very close with all of them, and I've got a very good relationship with them, and everybody knows my history. So I think they respect what I teach them or what I coach them or just our chats that we have. Mm. And there's lots of different, you know, different ways of dealing with anxiety, but end of the day, just go exercise because you're going to feel a lot better afterwards. And I think that's one thing as well too I'm loving with trail running, and I still can't quite put my finger on it, but it has to do with being in the trees and being grounded with Mother Nature and the smell of the soil and the oxygen in the trees. It's just a whole new high that I haven't experience before, so that side of things I'm really loving.
Mm. Like, so the thing, isn't it, you're running through a bio
sphere, verse, something, living things, you know, and they're respiring and they're resonating at different things. And forests are incredible. Like, they're incredible places.
Wow.
And yeah,
you feel so clean and just so, yeah, it's quite a, just so uplifting being
loving. And that's kind of, I guess I was sort of pondering as you were talking about it, there's kind of a couple of things going on. One, like when your husband would come home and then you would go for a run, you're getting away, you're getting a break from the situation that you're in that's, you know, stressful. But it's more than that, isn't it? It's more than that. It's the physical act of the running plus the, what you're talking about, being in the trees and in nature and so on. There's more going on this than just, taking a break.
I also think as well too, when you become a mother, you feel like there's this side of you, this identity that's being lost. And it was something that I was constantly worrying about, is that this identity of Jaime was going to be lost.
Right.
And I was going to become the boy's mom. And yeah, it was sort of always on my mind that I wanted to keep me going. And so that was, again, when my youngest was about five, that's when I said, I want to start something. I want to start a business for myself. I want to be able to do something that I feel of worth and helping people. So it's been a very rewarding
journey. Because gosh, haven't you done that?
And something I love as well too, everything about my what I do is I just love. This past weekend is been great with a lot of my female mums and runners taking part in the South Island Ultra.
Yeah.
And a few doing Rotorua.
Yeah.
As well too. So.
Yeah. Because it's the friendships as well, isn't it, that you create and, you know, develop and.
You get to see these people, especially I find it very rewarding to see some of my mums who come to me. And their main goal, first of all, is to sort of run to lose weight. And then you sort of go, oh, why don't you do a marathon? I can't do a marathon. I said, of course you can do a marathon. And then a year later, they're doing 100. Like, it's very cool to see.
Yeah.
That they're actually able to push the distances. And have more women in the sport is fantastic.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so good. It is. Yeah, it's one of them. I mean, I don't know. It's because I've always worked around mainly women. You know, I not say that I'm uncomfortable around dudes, I'm not, but it does for some reason it's strangely kind of comforting, you know, like spend all you sort of, it's like, oh yeah, I know what this is like, you know, like that environment. It's so good. It is, and it adds a different energy.
And women I've found as well too, women are competitive.
Oh, I guess.
Women have got a competitiveness about them. So awesome to see.
Smoked by so many women over the years. Yeah. Made a career out of it. And men too, let's be honest. Smoked by both genders, all genders.
How inviting is the environment of, well, I guess I'm thinking trail running particularly because that's where we kind of think, but running in general in New Zealand for women. Is it a welcoming place?
Road running?
Running in general.
Definitely so. I'm starting to see more trail runner and more women taking on the 100 kilometer distance. It's one that women come to me more often now to say, instead of going, oh, let's do the marathon, they come to me and say, let's do either the multi-day run or let's do a 100 kilometer race. And I think it's only going to be a matter of time, another year or two, where I'm going to have more of these women coming to me saying, let's do the miler. So women are...
Because that's the race where it's... Sorry. At Tarawera, that's the one that's still not as representative as it could be, is it? The miler.
Yeah. It's like 18%. What was the 102? Was it like 49%?
Yeah, the 100K is getting...
It's like 51.49, I want to say. And same with the 50K.
Yeah.
And the 21 was overwhelmingly women.
Yeah.
And then the 100 mile is like, it was 18%. Or was it a little bit more than that? Either 18, low 20s, high teens.
Yeah, so definitely more females coming through going, hey, let's do the 100.
Great.
It's not big and scary or whatnot. But what one thing is, women get quite nervous about going to trails by themselves.
Mm. Yes.
That I thought I'd deal with about, you know, I need you to get out to the trails. I'm like, well, where do I go to the trails? Yeah. I want to by myself. It's a sort of something that's, yeah, a bit tricky to work around. Mm.
It's kind of, I mean, that's a stigma. We talked about this, out on the trails, and I saw you. It was a bright summer's day. It's midday. It wasn't midday. It was early afternoon. It was so pleasant, open. And there's still that lingering, almost opportunistic, that small chance, but it is a chance. And it's just something that, I mean, I ran into a dude the other day on a motorbike with a machete. It was dead, like pitch black. And he had a couple of pig dogs with him and a machete, and he was on a trail bike. And I was in the forest. And I was like, hey, man. And he's like, hey, dude. And I don't. And it's privilege, right? I don't have to worry about it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, what have I got to be scared of?
Mm.
Yeah. I actually started taking up kickboxing about 8 weeks ago as well today. Because I said, damn it, I'm going to feel safe out there.
Yeah.
I'm just even just having a skill like that. It's just peace of mind, unfortunate, but it's a reality.
Yeah,
absolutely.
My coach, my trainer said, because you got the best defense ever, Jamie. He goes, you can run. You can run. But I want to be able to punch.
Yeah. Or I hurt someone. what can we as men do as trail running men of trail running? Is there anything that we should be doing to make it better?
I don't think that there is. I mean, it's just one of those things that it's unfortunate that fear's got to be there for females. I don't know if I have an answer for that, unfortunately.
And I just want to preface.
Women getting together with a friend, and maybe as things are growing, and there's more women that are training for milers together or doing, you know, big hours out on the trails, bringing those women together.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I can hear people in their heads saying, not all dudes do this.
No.
Already, and we're talking about this, but guys,
dudes. No,
I know, but what I'm saying is this.
There's so many awesome humans out there. It just takes that one just... And then it's just like even that incident that happened out at Tiaraha a couple of weeks ago. And then all of a sudden, you know, that sort of sits just in the back of your mind. And it just sort of, you're when you're out there on the trail by yourself, it's just sort of just sits there and you just go, no, it's okay.
Mm.
I mean, but the point I was trying to make was that's kind of a defense. And whilst that is true, it's something that we as men need to acknowledge.
Yep.
Openly and say, actually, yeah, sure, that is not all men. However, yeah. We need to kind of accept that fear is legitimate, right? Mm. And it's real for people. Mm. It's real for women.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
Mm.
I'm glad that you've figured out a way to get into the forest and enjoy it as much as you are. It's fantastic. Yeah. It's a great place, isn't it?
It's confidence. It's confidence.
Yeah.
It was something that I was like, I've got to do this.
Yeah.
And I've been wanting to do it for a while. And I know for the longevity of my running career, I need to get on trails more because road after a while it can be quite demanding on the legs.
Yeah.
And it's so beautiful out there. So why wouldn't you? I live so close to this amazing forest and I just want to take it in.
Yeah.
Kicking myself for not doing it sooner, but I got some new trail running shoes. So I had I did the Riverhead relapse in some, what were they? Challenger ATRs, but apparently I was told off that they're not proper mud shoes. So I went and I got some like proper red mud shoes and I went out to the forest today and I was like, all right. And they made a huge difference.
It's funny, isn't it? People talk about like you run what you brung, but if you got a good, and especially on clay, if you got a good pair of like trail shoes, the only kind of weird thing is resetting your psychology to think that if you just carry on, you're not going to fall over because they do hook up so well.
Mm.
Oh, just it was I did part of the relapse course today with them, and I'm going, oh my god, yeah. They're amazing.
Yeah, I'm not having to ski.
I wasn't skiing. What did somebody say? Like Bambi on ice. It was a bunch of Bambis on ice.
Yeah, fully.
Everywhere.
As a coach on that, in terms of gear, what, if someone comes to you and says, hey, look, I've got a limited spend, what is something that you would, a piece of gear or something that would give you a kind of your best value for money, bang for buck, if you were going to start out running?
Get yourself a proper pack. I find my pack goes everywhere with me, road or trail or whatnot. If you got a pack, you can put your phone in there. You can carry some fuel in there. You've got access to water. Even with, you know, running through COVID or whatnot, when all the water fountains were closed, you always had your supply of water with you. Invest in a good pack. It's sort of, try to sort of invest in a pack that's going to fit you properly.
Yep.
And probably spend a bit of money on the pack up front, because it lasts. I mean, I've had my pack for 4 years now, and it's just, it goes everywhere with me.
And you can stash so much in there, can't you? Like you say, even little first aid kit or an emergency blanket and things that just will give you that peace of mind and that confidence and that things that I can cope with stuff.
Yeah, like the thermal or just having your phone with you having a pack is sort of
quite
important. I go everywhere with
me.
That's a good tip.
Beers. We've done that.
We have, yeah.
We did 20.20 kilometres on the last day of 2020, and I jammed a whole bunch of, turns out like a 2-litre, one of the bladders will hold a sixer really, really nicely if you jam them in.
And he even bought a non-alcoholic beer for me.
Yeah,
well. So I don't drink, so how kind is that?
You got to be accommodating and inclusive. Why don't you drink? Spray him a beer. Yeah. Look, Jaime, this has been a wonderful conversation, enlightening, and we're so thankful to have you on. And you know, you've been really generous with your time. I mean, we'd like to finish up by asking you the same question we ask everyone who comes on Dirt Church Radio, and that's, hey, Jaime Stevenson, what's been your greatest run ever?
So probably my run where I gave it my absolute all, and there was nothing but a broken mess at the end, would have been Alps to Ocean 2020. I had to work really hard for that podium. Yeah. It wasn't pretty. I was a broken, sobbing mess at the end of it. It was 7 days of just pushing, racing. No, you know, I had a minimum requirement of 2,200 calories a day. I lost like 6 kilos. I was just a mess. I came through the finish line and second place was 4 minutes behind me, and I had to make this time up on the last day. So I had to race hard 28 kilometers that last day. And yeah, so that was probably... Wow. It sits in my mind as the race that I gave it my absolute all, and I had nothing left to give at the end. So,
and you won.
I won it.
Yeah.
It was good.
Is it
pretty, but it was freaking amazing.
Is it? I hate pretty wins, though. Don't you?
Like someone, I wouldn't know. No. I wouldn't know. I'll take anything.
Me too. I'll take what I can get. But when you see something, like I want, in my head, I want Zach Miller.
Right.
I want TNF 50 Zach Miller.
Yeah.
You know, like the running.
Rasping.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even though
fighting.
He's got a course record and there's no one behind. Mm, yeah. Mm. Fantastic. On the Alps to Ocean, sorry to carry this on, you say you're 4 minutes behind. Is that you're 4 minutes behind, or she was 4 minutes behind on the clock, or she's actually 4 minutes down the road?
She was four minutes ahead of me.
Right.
The last day. So I had to make up 4 minutes.
All right.
I had to make up 5 minutes just to get the win.
So it's like not like Tour de France where you can win the thing even if you're placed 70th. over time you actually had to
because it was cumulative time, so it was you know, I was running for whatever it was 33 hours whatnot. So when we came in day five, she had 4 minutes ahead of me,
right? Mm-hmm.
And so in order for me to win, I needed to get that 4 minutes plus.
Right.
So you need to beat her by 4 minutes plus. Yeah.
So in the end, I think it was about 3 or 4 minutes.
Wow.
Wow.
So you got after it.
I was giving it my all. And one of my friends came out on course, his name's Glenn Marvin. And he said to me, he goes, "Jamie, she's right behind you. You have to give it your all." And I looked at him and I said, "I'm giving it my all. You have to dig more." I was like, "There's nothing left inside of me." But somehow I managed to just freaking keep it going. And
yeah,
I came through the finish line and I ran into the race director, Michael Sandries, and I gave him a hug. And I just remember leaning on him and I'm going, "She's really close behind me." Because I had no idea. And I just sort of sat there and I cried and cried and cried.
Oh.
And waited. And yeah. And then he didn't even announce the winner until prize giving. So,
wow.
It was all very, very emotional.
How dramatic.
It was very dramatic. And I think that's why it was one of my,
most. No wonder.
Amazing race.
No wonder.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Jaime, thank you so, so much for sharing that and everything else that you've shared with us in this conversation. We really, really appreciate it.
Yeah. Oh, it's our pleasure. Like that was, And it was really nice actually. It was really lovely getting to run with you first. That was a real treat. That was like.
Yeah, that was really nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was quite a surprise. I saw this person flying down the hill behind me and I was like, Matt, I know you. I just met you. So it was really nice running
together. And I'm blind as a bat without my glasses, so I was like, there's a horse on one side and a person on the other. Cool, I'll shoot for the gap for the middle. That's right. Because there was a horse, randomly there was this horse with a rider on it, since a horse. There's a person riding a horse.
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
Me and Riggs, I'm getting amongst them. Fantastic. Look, right. Jaime, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you guys. Thank you.
My energy is uplifted, eh?
Yeah.
End of a long day. And just felt that lift. That lift of energy. And we hope you felt that lift of energy. Jaime, thank you so much. Yeah.
How lucky are her coaching clients?
Yeah, absolutely.
To be energized like that.
Yeah, fully. Even if they didn't want, I reckon even if you're just having the most kind of self-indulgent day, you're like, I just can't be, okay, feeling a bit better.
Yes.
You know. Hey, look, fantastic. We'll put the links up to Glenn Sutton. Run, we'll put the links up to Jaime's business. Fantastic. Thank you very much for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio, and you can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on all the podcast platforms. You can like and subscribe if you fancy, and you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com.
Don't forget to send in your greatest run ever. We love to hear them, and you can read them on the website too, and people love doing that.
Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running, Further Faster, Spring Energy, and Cielo. And thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thanks to our editor, Kieran. And we've got a really great show lined up for you next week. So please tune in then. Ka kite.
Ka kite. Thanks, Rigby.